Oh. to keep that spiritual water flowing.
Yeah.
Gotta take a little dip from the well. Yes, sir. Yeah. Come on, sing, come to the well. If y'all know it, just sing along.
Yes, sir.
I have what you need. Hey.
dipping in a muddy puddle of dead, stagnant water. And pour it through a purification process as this one right here. And it comes out 99.9999% pure. There is a metamorphosis that took place right there. A complete change of something. And as Jesus sit on that well that day, and that woman done something repetitious for years and years on end, coming and dipping some natural water that can only suffice the natural. He said, if you will drink of this well, come on somebody. And just like that purification system just takes dirty water and makes it clean. How many knows when you surrender your head, heart, body, soul to Jesus? How many knows he takes your old wretchedness, as despicable as you was, and tainted as we are, and he makes us clean by his precious blood? Can somebody clap your hands and praise him? The Lord. Amen. Without God, where would we be? Amen. Glory to God. We would be forever lost and doomed and diseased in our own transgressions. But the Lord, come on now, but the Lord. Glory to God. Isn't the Lord good?
Amen.
Let's see where we at this morning. Much craziness and chaos is going around this world. Seems like America's following suit. I mean, knows we need some authority.
Yes, sir.
This spiritual aspect, the concepts of who Christ is, he's more than a myth. He's more than a crutch.
Yes.
He becomes Lord and Savior. Yes, he is. The book of Mark, chapter number 11. Mark, chapter number 11. Glory to God. Mark, chapter 11. Let's see. Let's look at verse number. Start at 27. Amen. Good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Invite you, if you've not already caught the concept, just invite you to just freely worship the Lord. Amen. For the Spirit of the Lord, there's liberty. Mark 11:27, they come again to Jerusalem, and as he was walking into the temple, there came to him the chief priests and the scribes and the elders. The religious crowd came to him and saying to him, by what authority doeth thou these things? He's been out doing miracles, proclaiming the kingdom of God. They ask him, by what authority doest thou these things? And who gave thee this authority to do these things? And Jesus answered and said unto them, why? I will also ask of you one question, and answer me, and I will tell you by what authority do I these things. Kind of like a trade-off. He said, I'm not going to tell you nothing until you answer my question. He said, the baptism of John, was it from heaven or of men? Answer me. And they reasoned with themselves, saying, ain't it funny how religion always does this? They always got to try to think. Now, wait a minute.
Yeah, that's right.
They reasoned with themselves, saying, if we shall say from heaven, Jesus will say, well, why then did ye not believe me? Or believe him, John? But if we shall say of men, they feared the people, for all men counted John that he was a prophet indeed. And they answered and said unto Jesus, we cannot tell. And Jesus answered and said unto them, neither do I tell you by what authority I do these things. That was probably one of those times it was a mic drop and he just simply took his disciples and went on and healed somebody else. Delivered somebody else. Cured somebody else. Restored somebody else. Because that's what Jesus does, right? Let's pray. Father, we give you praise and glory and honor. We thank you for all that you're doing. Lord, I pray that you just open our mindsets, our understandings to be able to perceive and to hear and to learn the word of God here today, Father. Every need, Father, we pray, God, bind any spirit that's not like you, oh God, any distraction, Father, we pray now. Lord, have your liberty in this house as we careful to give you the glory, praise, and honor. We ask all this in Jesus' wonderful name, and will the church say amen.
Amen.
And amen. Glory to God. I want to preach a thought this morning, simply the right to the ruler. The right to the ruler. Amen. How many knows that the Lord Jesus Christ is our government? He is our ruler in the spiritual aspect. You know, because we've been seen and it's proven over and over and over that if you put your confidence in man will always lead you the wrong direction.
Yes, sir.
If you put all your confidence in the character of this modern world that we live in today, it will always lead you astray. Now, sure, as ministers of the gospel, we need to be able to say, follow us as we follow Christ. But friend, that's not to put all your confidence in a man. No, sir. You put your confidence in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Because we know that he will never lead you astray. He will always lead you down the right paths. He will lead you into places at times that you won't go on your own self. Because we don't like the trials and the problems. We don't like to commit ourselves, amen, knowing if there's going to be a problem down the road. But Jesus was teaching here the word of God, and his religion come to ask him a question, trying to entrap him. If the Pharisees and the scribes would have been legit to say, Lord, we need to know. We want to know. And Jesus would have discerned that they asked of the rightness of their heart. But they're always asked the Lord questions to try to intrigue him or to take him captive. And friend, how many knows that the Lord's mind, the mind of God, amen, that could not be deceived. It could not be tampered with. It could not be tricked. Amen. But he was the perfect, amen, son of man here on this earth as God in heaven. So we find out this morning, they wanted to know about whose authority. Now the word authority there in the Greek simply means access. Access. I want you to hold on to that word for a while. We'll come back and visit it after a while. But they wanted to know about his authority. And that's simply the right or power to enforce rules or to give orders. Now I want you to get this. The right or to enforce rules or give orders. Now, we don't have no problem giving orders. We all like to be the boss. You ain't got to say amen. You know, you men, you are the boss of your home until the wife comes home. Come on. And all you smart men better say amen right here. Glory to God. I mean, we think, if not careful, you know, we earth authority sometimes on our jobs when it's really not ours to come on. If not careful, we try to manipulate the systems to make us rise to a level possibly that we're really not there. But all these things, this what the Sadducees and the scribes and the Pharisees would do. That Jesus called, said they stand on the street corners in their long righteous robes and they're making these repetitious prayers. That's not going to help nobody. They always tried to bring taxation on the common person. They always tried to keep them under bondage and law in the surroundings that they were at. But then Jesus said, but you know yourself, don't lift a finger to help anybody. But when Jesus walked the streets of Jerusalem or Bethany or wherever he found himself, so he was a man of authority. He had the right or the power to enforce the rules. Simply said, he had a legitimate power because his power came from above. Because when Jesus went to the river of baptism and John the Baptist was baptized, and the word of God said, John looked at him and said, behold the Lamb of God. And as Jesus is baptized by John, the word of God says, and the Spirit of the Lord descended as of a dove and lit upon him. He went out of that river of baptism with the power and the authority of the celestial realms of God himself. As the Lord promoted his sovereign plan on earth through the Lord Jesus Christ by the empowerment of the Holy Ghost. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
He's legitimate. It's a legitimate. It's a legitimate access. When Jesus would end speaking, people would be astonished at his doctrine. He taught them, the Bible says, that as one having authority. And I love this part, and not as the scribes. Do you see the power of this? That the Bible is so plain. The Bible says, I'm going to give you a comparison. You got Jesus in his words. His words promote power, authority, amen. But then he said, but not as the scribes. Like they've always told the same old thing. They've always acted the same old way. They always try to put men in the same old bondage. But when the Lord would walk into their church circles, and he would just speak to the devil, and the devil would be bound. Amen. And the man would be loosed. When he looked at the blinded eyes and he spoke, they saw for the first time. Why? Because there's a right. There's a right of privilege there from God himself, but not only to Jesus Christ. But aren't you glad today that the same power of the Spirit of God that resonates in you and I, that if we walk according to the Word of God, we will have the right to the ruler, friend. Right to the ruler. Luke 9 and 1, Jesus gave his disciples power and authority over all devils and to cure diseases. And all through the scriptures, you know, they come back proclaiming to Jesus, man, we cast out a devil. And the Lord said, don't be so excited about that. As you should be excited because your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. But what he was simply saying here is, I've given you that right now. I've given you that power to usurp authority over the enemy. I believe at times, if not careful, when the devil comes a knocking, we give him too much leeway. We ask him instead of telling him he's got to go. Come on. We don't usurp the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ and the Spirit of the Lord. We fool around and almost try to bargain with him. If you'll stay on your side, we'll stay on ours. If you don't bother me, we won't bother you. But can I tell you, if it's in a household of faith like this setting, or it's the middle of Walmart or on your job, if God puts into your spirit to take that step into earth of authority over a principality, a ruler of dark places, over death or disease, that's the very time you just simply take that step forward. Because if the Lord put it on your heart, he's giving you the right of the authority of the finish. It becomes a privilege to work for God. Glory to God. Listen, there's Roman authority in this Bible, though, too. Paul said in Acts 26 and 10, he had the authority to cast Christians into prison. That's what they were talking about Paul here. That Paul had the authority when he was Saul of Tarsus to cast Christians into prison. But because his authority came with no right, his authority worked against the order of God, making it Roman authority, right? When he was Saul of Tarsus, he was a very powerful man. He was as powerful in the natural and the religious as he became in the spiritual. But yet, the first power and authority he had was not the power of God. It was a power of man. It was a power of religion, okay? And that makes people very prominent to these days. They fly around in their jet airplanes. They go around in their limousines and their entourage. And they think they're more than they really are. And I'm not, listen, but what I'm saying, that's Roman authority. And Roman authority has no privilege of God. But yet, because religion, it becomes a sum of a man's mind instead of the power of God. God in our heart, then we begin to, amen, you see copycats and all these things that burst from these things. It's called false doctrine, false profession, false religion, etc., etc. But before there was a false friend, thank God there was a truth. I said before the devil ever stood up and manipulated the mind of Adam and Eve, there was a true God back then. There was a true God in the beginning of the New Testament. There's still a true God today. His name is Jesus Christ, the hope of glory, glory to God. And we're doing this work under His leadership. Did you get that? And we work under His leadership. And then and how many knows Saul of Tarshish became Paul the Apostle? And his Roman authority got turned upside down. Come on, somebody. And when it's said and done, now they say, let him, he's blind as a bat. They led him down and put him in a house. And God sent a man and said, go down to the street called Straight and lay hands on Brother Saul. He fixed to get a new name change because he's got a new right now. You see, he's got a privilege now that he once didn't possess. He was educated. He was very religious. Everybody wanted him in his circles. He was persecuting Christians. Amen. But now, because God's going to give him the right to give him the privilege and the power, let's say it like this, access. He's got access to the kingdom of God now. And we find out, glory to God, we find out with the right access of God, all things are possible through the Lord Jesus Christ now. So eventually, he would possess the right authority by receiving the right power. In Acts 1 and 8, you shall receive what?
Power
after that the Holy Ghost comes upon you to fulfill the high calling that was his to fulfill. Now think about this. It's God's will for us to work in the office of the high calling, right? Yes. And it doesn't matter. You know, the people look at a pulpit and says, well, he's a pastor. He's got more knowledge, more. Well, we might need to, but sometimes, you know, because it don't come from man's intellect. It comes by the birthing of the Spirit of God. And that's how these things move and operate. Friend, you're not going to take Jesus and lead him. Jesus is going to lead you, friend. And what's happening in such these big religious arenas now, they think they can pop their fingers and stop heaven dead in his tracks, but it don't happen like that. The only reason Jesus stopped when Bartimaeus called out to him, Jesus, Son of David! Jesus stopped and said, bring him to me. It wasn't, he wasn't forced to stop. He wasn't even begged to stop, but he felt something inside of him. Said, there's a man that's got faith right there. And it was proved when he got up. Bartimaeus stood up and he cast his beggar's garment off of him, saying, I'm through with that kind of lifestyle. I'm through having to depend on ordinary provision. When the spiritual provider has just called me by name. The right to the ruler, friend. Yes, sir. Great revelation lies within the scriptures of Matthew 16. We quote this all the time. I believe it's one of the greatest revelation that you find when a disciple is walking with the Lord. He's walking with the Lord. Amen. And the Lord, now watch this. The Lord puts his finger on him and says, okay, who do men say that I am? And they tell him. And then he puts his finger on them. Why? Because he's an individual. He's an individual saver, right? He saves. He'll save by the mass, but in the whole consistency of the mass, it's a one-on-one.
Yes, sir.
10 get saved in that meeting over there. But yeah, 10 got saved, but now wait, the Lord met them one by one because he's individual. Glory to God. So we find out that revelation now that is so powerful, the great revelation that lies within the scripture. Jesus is asked, who do you say that I am? And Simon Peter said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood have not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will, not that I might,
that's right.
Not that I hope,
come on.
Yeah.
We always quote this, but I just wanted to slow it down and just, I want you to hear this. Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Now let me throw an anchor right there for just a second. I will build my church, not on the tone of Peter's answer, but the revelation of Peter's heart and mind. Understand, because that's why the religion can get Peter to be the doorkeeper of heaven. Peter ain't a doorkeeper of heaven. Glory, how many knows heaven is open wide to those that's called by his name? Glory to God. There's not having that the watchman I said the soldier, the man with the spear. No, none of that's going to have to guard the presence of God in heaven, not in the celestial. The only place that had to happen was in the first creation of the garden, when man and woman sinned and fell from grace. The Lord took a sword that was on fire, and he put it in the mouth or the gate of that garden and said, you can't come back like you are now. You got sin in your heart. Amen. But watch this. That sword would turn to the north, south, east, or the west. It wasn't but one way into that garden. Glory to God. It wasn't nobody going to slip up and crawl over the back fence. Jesus said they're a thief. If they don't come in by me, the Lord would say. I'm here to tell you, man, there ain't still but one way to heaven. All these religious and denominational wars. My way it don't matter who you are. If you this, you this, you this. They all say they got the way. They all the right ones. Don't you? Why would I want to preach something that I couldn't back up the Word of God? Yeah. But it's the Word of God, birthed by the Spirit of God. And Jesus said, I will build my church on that revelation, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I want to tell you there's power when you get the right to the ruler, friend. He is the ruler. He's the majestic majesty of high. Glory to God. He's the one that does the summons. We're the one that shows up and bows. Oh, friend, yes, sir. Religion these days, they want to know. No. I said, he's the one that does the summons. And when your name is called, when the Lord calls your name, you take that step forward and be like Isaiah. In all of our worthlessness, Isaiah saw the Lord high and lifted up. Isaiah had plenty of religion. He wasn't scared to preach. He wasn't scared to prophesy. He wasn't scared to point. Woe to you, woe to you. But in the year that King Uzziah died, I also saw the Lord high and lifted up. And when you saw the Lord, it wasn't no raising yourself up no more. You got to go down now. You see, you've been summoned to come up hither. But before you get summoned in Revelation chapter 4 by John, the Lord said, come up hither. Before that happens, there's got to be a man in a prayerful, humble state of being.
Yes.
Come on now. Arrogance will get you nowhere but a flames of hell. But when we're humble before the Lord, glory to God. Oh, yes, sir. Don't just go wrong. Just come in a place somewhere and I want the cheap seat. Move. Let me move. Let me sit right there. That's a cheap seat. Come on. Come on. We get arrogant like that in our religious. Stay right there. I ain't flirting with your wife either. No, this is a cheap seat. Jesus said, don't you do that. He said, you go in, you find the low seat. At least somebody with more importance come and take your seat. Take your rightful seat now, husband. Glory to God. I want to tell you, friend, if not careful, we promote ourselves too much. We promote our agendas too often. Amen. Can I tell you? I can tell you how it's going to work. It's going to work by thus saith the Lord. That's why we want the right to the ruler, friend. He's the ruler. Amen. Oh, and think about this physical ruler. They used one back in school. They would tap you on the knuckle sometimes if you weren't paying attention with it. But it had a bunch of little marks on it. We just want the hash marks. But we all together become the body to make the ruler readable. Come on. And the measurements right. Because if we don't have the hash marks, then we got to guess. We'll say we got it right. But we don't know if that ruler is authentic, amen, until it's put to the here. You and I, we don't make the whole body. We make one part. But when we're all functioning or hitting on the same right cylinder, then we begin to be off. And we might cause confusion to the weak out there to say, I don't understand that. That's why we got to be careful not to become an offense to people. Right? Say amen, somebody. Yeah, but I know you say it all, but I ain't never caused an offense. I've never been an offense to nobody. Well, good for you. All right. I don't have the time to throw another anchor right there. I got some more to throw further now. Look here. Remember now, in this, watch this. In this revelation, what's flying under the radar, you got to know when this is happening in the ministry of Jesus here on this earth. Brother Greg, it was the three years of ministry, and Jesus' ministry on earth was broken apart. And this was the year of opposition. Think about that. This was the year of opposition now. And he's not as popular as he once was. Now the only reason they follow him is because they know he'll feed them. But there's a lot of opposition now. And the Lord says, upon this revelation, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And he goes on to say, I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth. Look what he's doing. He's waiting on us to bind some things on earth. He says, shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Now think about this now. We find there's a year of opposition. There's a kickback. There's a pushback happening. The scribes and the Pharisees are jealous. They're full of envy. The Bible says that they are. They're pushing back on him. They don't want their little playhouses messed up. They've been in the religious arenas for a long time. They've been calling the shots. They've been taking command and charge over people's lives. And then all of a sudden, glory to God, one steps in. Come, the Bible said he walks in, and they put a book in his hand, and he stands up for the read, and he begins to read Isaiah, glory to God, and he says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Come on now. And everybody in that house said, wait a minute, he's reading that with power. He's reading it like he's got some authority to back this up. And they begin to understand that he's more than a man. He's been sent here more than just some denomination. He's been sent here by, oh my God, but they did not want to break their stranglehold or chokehold on the ways that they've done things for. If only they would have just repented and resigned their mentality and committed their hearts to God, then, oh my God, but even though when the bulk of them would not submit, there's one like Nicodemus. He's going to come in the night, amen, and ask for the body of Jesus. That's why we keep preaching. That's why I'm still holding spiritual debates with people that think they're all that and then some. I don't try to prove that what we've got is more than what somebody else has got. What we need to learn to prove is the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. Religion will jump on you. Religion gets mad and will jump on you. And they throw about 1,000 rules right in your lap. Come on now. Listen. We find out that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. This revelation produces forward progress in the building of the church. Now think about this. This revelation begins to produce forward progress in the building of the church. I'm not talking about a four-cornered building here. Paul said, you are the temple of the Holy Ghost, right? And listen, proper building codes has to be attained now. Now, anytime there's building, especially when you're in the city limits, you don't just, like, maybe a long time ago, they just throw some stuff together, but not anymore. The inspector comes and he will shut you down in a heartbeat unless you've got the proper credentials. Come on, somebody. That he's got to sign off on. Oh, we were building that building in Jonesboro. Ooh, he was a rough one. I'm going to tell you, you'd have thought he was worse than a tax collector. He'd come in, man, he's hollering and screaming, get off that ladder now. I ain't giving you the permission to do that. Had one of my guys, he's bigger than I was, and not only body, but in desire. Glory to God. I'm like, whoa, let me pull him back. But he's like, you give me the permission, I'll throw him right out here on his head. I said, no, I'm not giving you that kind of permission. That's wrong authority. Come on. He will get us all in trouble. We'll never see this building completed. But it's got to be proper building codes. And that's what I was teaching there. All right, this is what they say. You can't change it. Glory to God. So just build it according to these specs right here. And he'd come in. That old man would come in looking for something to write on. I said, looking to try to find a fault. Oh, man, I hated that man's spirit. I love the man, but I hated that spirit because he's a fault-finding spirit. Oh, wait a minute. Oh, let me see now. I think there's something wrong with you. There's something wrong with you. That's what the scribes and the Pharisees done Jesus. They always listen not to get better in life, not to submit their ways to God, but they always listen and try to fault find, manipulate, point a finger at. Always wanted to try to destroy the whole work of the kingdom of God. But when Peter said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, oh, the revelation of the knowledge of who God is. Oh yeah, it wasn't but a minute later, Jesus calls Peter the devil. But here's the fault finding. We'll remember that more than we'll remember what God himself said. Yes, right. We've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. Do we ordain sin? Absolutely not. If grace abounds, shall we remain in sin? God forbid. Right? But there's times in our life, that's why you got to stay spiritually. You got to stay spiritually desiring to move with God, to touch the Lord, to speak to the Lord, and to have him speak to you. What I'm simply saying, you don't need to run around looking back all the time. You don't need to be so antsy and scared because you're trying to hide something that God sees already. Come on. There's no hiding from the Lord. He's God. He knows where we at. He knows what we do. He'll know what you do when you come here 7 days a week, but he'll still know what you do if you go 1,000 miles on a vacation somewhere. He knows. And I thank the Lord for that there's an all-seeing eye and an all-hearing ear that can hear us. Amen. That we can prevail on his provisions, not ours. I said we'll prevail on his promises, not ours. It's always about him, friend, and we'll continually point to him. We'll see people saved.
Yes, sir.
We'll see glory to God. Look now, the church. Now, we did building codes. Think about it. Here's the code book right here. Sister Harriet picked this Bible up a while ago. This is what you better stay in this right here. You better stay. There's the building codes. Oh, we're workmen in progress. Oh, yes, sir. The workman's working. We the work. He's the potter. We're the clay. All through the Bible, you see it taught like this, that it's all about his hands. It's his desire. It's his will that we're trying to fulfill here. And we can't do it on modern education. We must do it through the submissiveness of our own being to be completely sold out to the Savior, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. Can you say amen?
Amen.
So he says now, I'll give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Think about this. The church basically means the called out. The called out would become God's testimony of power and authority here on earth. Think about this. The church has become the testimony of the power and authority here on this earth. It's simply keys. He said, I'll give you the keys of the kingdom. Did he not? I said, he'll give you the keys of the kingdom. Now, what are we doing with the keys? The keys are for two purposes, to lock something, but also to unlock something. But understand, it's the Holy Ghost coupled with our faith. That's the tool that enables a piece of metal to become a key. Now, what do you say, piece of metal? You and I. The workmanship of God. It's by his spirit and coupled with our faith that allows him to notch out or carve away all these things that's not pleasing to him. They you said, I need a duplicate of this key. They take your master key, but then they take one that has no teeth on it. They put it in the same machine, but one's a master, one's a duplicate. Come on. But the duplicate is no good until it goes through the process of change. Glory to God. And my God, think about it. I get some bad sounds. I hear a lot of grinding going on. I see chips of stuff falling out the bottom. My God, they take it off. They're not through with it yet. It's still rough around the edges. So now they got to shave it off with a grinding wheel, this wire wheel, to knock all the edges off. Come on, somebody. Do you know you and I, we're still the duplicate. He's still the master. It's a process.
Yeah. Amen.
How many likes to hear that dentist drill go off in your mouth? And then I don't know, but used to they would just grind till the smoke would come out of your mouth. Oh God. I still get weak thinking about it. Anybody ever had a bad experience with an old dentist?
Yeah.
I don't know what possessed my mama to take me to the dentist after the man had just had a stroke, and I think it was his first day back. When he wasn't supposed to be back for another year. And I knew something was up when he kicked me back. He's got a, son, you got a cavity. Well, I know that. It hurts. I know that. Well, I'm going to have to drill. Well, I figured that. But he comes in my mouth with that drill and it's doing that right there. He touched 12 teeth before he got to the right one. I should have just jumped up and ran right then. He stuck that and he bogged it down and the smoke's a flying. And he didn't stop at the bottom of the cavity. He went on down, and I guarantee you, this part, well, I wasn't as fat back then, but I figured that old bit come out somewhere right down in there. It left me so messed up that I'm telling you, I couldn't pass down a construction site and hear a drill go off. I'm like a cat in a room full of rocking chairs. I'm running around here trying to get out of there because I'm going to tell you, put the fear in me. I want to tell you, friend, there's another fear, but it's a godly fear. And we'll just learn to just bow down to our Heavenly Father, and we don't have to fear Him. No, sir, we fear Him out of respect and love, but we love Him enough to fear Him out of respect and love because He's doing a work within you. And sometimes it's a long process, and when you think it's all over, well, guess what? You'll mess up again. So then again, you've got to get back and get you connected back to the lifeline. That we loose.
Yeah.
What do we loose? Demon possessed folks.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes. Elder said it a while ago. We don't see what they used to see because we don't do what they used to do.
Right.
Come on. He's unchangeable, guys.
Yeah.
He ain't look, all these newfangled things all these churches do, they don't impress God.
No.
It might impress somebody else, but it don't impress God. Why? Because He's unchangeable. She said it the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now the new thing, because I get that thrown in my lap, oh, but God said Isaiah that He'll do a new thing. Well, understand, the rapture's going to be a new thing. And God, by your permission, will sanctify you, that you'll start doing new things. Come on. Now you're so addicted to the bottle. I'm speaking about myself now. Now all of a sudden I'm delivered, and now I can seek out people that's bound to the bottom, and I don't go to judge them or condemn them, but I can go and help them because I know where they are. Come on, somebody, I know where they are. Glory to God, because I was there myself. It's hard to preach to somebody. That's why it's hard for these little kids to preach sin to grown people, because in themselves they're just now coming to a place. Some of them not even an age of accountability yet. So they'll say, "Oh, you sinners," and I'm like, "Well, now be careful here, you little junior, because your life just fixed to start now." Well, oh, yes, sir. But you take a man or a woman, you put a drug addict, amen, that's been born again and full of spirit, and a room full of drug addicts, they're going to know exactly Jesus. Jesus is your answer. Jesus is your answer. Amen. I was bound to all that stuff too. Yes, sir. I wish to God I had a better testimony on my past, but it was a rotten. I was rotten to the core. Now, was things in my life I'm still ashamed of today, but everything that I've ever been, every word I ever said, everything I've ever done, has been put under the precious blood of Jesus. Aren't you glad this morning that He has washed us white as snow? There's always going to be an old fall trying to dig up a bomb. I can't believe you let him come to this church. I'll tell you, and I hope that never happens to you, but if it does, I can probably come and pop my face and say, I don't want to hear a word of it. You just open your mouth and prove that you're worse than him right now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen. Don't shout me down.
Amen. But we do. We like to remember. Now, we put our ways of remembrance. We stir up this gift that sits by the way of remembrance. Man, I wish I had her testimony. It, to the fact that I was raised in church, I wasn't. A lot of things elders had to endure that I never endured, so I can't really exactly express the same level of pain or interruption of life like she suffered. But here she is. She's, come on, somebody. She's still here. Glory to God. Look, some of you had every reason in the natural to quit God a long time ago, but that ain't why. It's because it ain't natural. It's spiritual. And God will never give you a spiritual reason. And He makes us the promise of this. If we'll hold on, glory to God, our day's coming. The day of reckoning. The day of reconciliation. The day of hope. The day of help. We might be hopeless. We might be helpless. We might not have no recognition with nobody today. But we've been endured late for a night. But joy's going to come back in the morning. I know, my God, I woke up this morning. I looked at that clock. I want to just testify. She woke me up this morning. I looked at that clock. I had to remember now. Have I set the time for the time change? If I have, I'm in Houston. We got a problem now. Glory to God. But I woke up thinking about that as I was getting ready, prepared. I was already prepared for this service this morning, but I had to prepare myself for the service on hand. And while I was getting prepared, I got to thinking about the hour change. What the difference of 1 hour can make there. Jesus, glory to God. I said the 1 hour difference. If you didn't run that clock ahead, you could always be early or late. Jesus took his disciples and he said, hey, watch with me. Come on. For an hour, I'm going to go yonder and pray. And he came back 3 times and they're asleep every time. What the difference an hour would have made. I still believe that Peter would have obeyed that voice and prayed diligently for that hour. When he got up and walked to that garden, he's not pulling a sword trying to cut a man's ear off now. He finally gets to understand in the mindset of the Lord. What a difference an hour would make. Glory to God. That's time. I love listening to her. She's doing me a tremendous service by teaching while we go to Kentucky, and we've just been prolonged before we go to Kentucky. But thank God. Amen. It's always in God's time. Listen, I'm almost done, but listen. I said the Holy Ghost coupled with faith is the tool that enables a piece of metal to become a key. I said the grinding, oh, and the carving out and the notching out of the surface, friend. God's a doing something in you. There's been times you might have left this church kind of upset. Well, the preacher just was too hard on me today. The preacher today was just, he seemed like he didn't love me as much as he says he does. And all that devil will try to tell you all kind of things. But let me tell you, sometimes we'll leave with feeling a little sour, a little sore. Anybody ever left sour or sore?
Yes, sir.
Well, stay with us long enough, you'll leave sour or sore something. That's the Holy Ghost dealing with us.
Yeah.
Dear God, I used to sit in church and there might have been 75 people in the building. And I said, he just got both his feet on my feet and his nose is against my nose, preaching straight to me. And I left the church before a few times a little sour. I didn't understand. Dear God. There was a couple of times we left the church, it went about eight, nine people there. And I'm like, good grief. But you know when I went home and prayed? You know what the Holy Ghost told me one time? He said, I was talking to you. Now come on, now that's when we would say, oh, that's the devil talking. No. When you hear God's voice, you know it's God. God's got to deal with us. Lest we lose the edge. Come on, get ready for it, John. You got a sharp pocket knife in your pocket? Is it sharp? Don't be sharp enough. Okay, that's all I need to know right there. Behave yourself. Well, you know when you find out if your knife's sharp or not, when you get ready to use it. You lift that old bucktail and go to carving on that old hide or squirrel tail or just anything, whittling, carving out something, and all of a sudden it's just not as sharp. That would cut you. For certain, I'm going to close it before I get cut now. Amen. But I was working years ago. I was still growing up in the logging woods, and we parked our equipment behind an old couple's house in Pitkin, Louisiana, or on the outskirts of it, and was cutting some timber behind their house. So every evening, the Ma and Pa would be out there on the front porch, and she's got a big mouthful of snuff. I mean, not even tobacco, it's snuff. She spit. And what didn't go off the porch fell on the porch, and I'm like, well, I'm gonna sit over here by Paul, you know? And I don't know, there was always a stick, Paul's always whittling or something, and I pulled my knife out. And I'm just sitting out there doodling with that knife, and she said, she clears her throat, and she says, son, that knife looks dull. I said, well, I guess. She said, you know what that's a sign of, don't you? I'm like, now, wait a minute. She said, a dull knife is a sign of a lazy man.
Ooh.
See, anybody got a wet rock real quick? Break open his old boot, try to sharpen it up on the tooth or anything, you know? But that's what she thought. That's been since I was that high. I ain't forgot it. It made an impact.
Yeah.
And then she spit snuff in him. That's all she had to say. And I thought about that a million times. Every time I get ready to skin something or whittle something or cut something, I go back to that thought. You and I, we can be so sharp in the things of the Lord one day. But if not careful, Scripture says our hearing can become dull.
Amen.
How is that? Because after a while, it just becomes common. What you get here becomes common. I guarantee you, probably none of us is eating T-bones and ribeye steak very often, especially not every night.
Nope.
But if things were different, it was affordable, and we would eat the same cut of meat, the very quality cut of meat, over and over and over, or change that with your favorite dish, whatever it might be, over and over and over and over, there's going to come a day you're not going to appreciate it. In fact, the thing that used to just get you so excited, oh, my favorite meal.
Yeah.
There'll come a day if you get it over and over and over, you got to guard yourself. You'll say, oh, no, not this again.
Yeah. That's right.
You'll become dull. Jesus said, as the word of God is being preached and the word of God is being demonstrated, he'll use the foolish things to confound the wise even. And the word of God's being taught. Amen. And it's good. It sharpens us. It sharpens us. Glory to God. But if not careful, we dismiss ourselves from the wet rock, from the old wet rock. Oh, yes, sir. The sharpening tool now. Understand, friend, where there's going to come a day that Jesus is going to stand and out of his mouth is going to come a two-edged sword. One of those is to cut sin off of your life. But if you don't let God do his perfect work with you, you'll be cut off the vine. Oh, friend, listen. Never reject the wet rock. No matter how sharp you feel like you are, don't ever get so stagnant or normal. Don't ever get so relaxed that now the word of God is not finding its right place. There's a lot of chambers in the heart. Hey, tell me the echogram, brother. Ronnie was trying to tell me the other day, because my mom's got to have, he's had these. He said it shows pictures, all of the heart, inside and out. I got to thinking, Brother Ronnie, that's exactly what God does. He shows us every part of that heart. Yes, he does. Will you stand this morning? And I want you to ask God a question. Lord, am I who I say I am? Is it time for me to go back to the grinding stone? Is there another notch of something that you need to take out of me? Is there something you called me to do that I'm not fulfilling? Is there something in my heart I'm not confess? Is there a place that I need to go to prevail over the enemy? Or is it that I've lost my peace now that I can't find my way? Whatever it is. Whatever it is. Maybe you hear and you just say, oh, well, all's good right now. And I thank God for that. I wish the church, we could always say that every time. I wish we didn't have to go through trials and tribulations and problems. And I wish we didn't have to go through circumstances and situations. But even in the time that you might have lost your peace, God says you still can prevail through His Spirit. And that's the good news. Because you see, if you're the church, if you are born again here today, you've got the right to the ruler. He's the same one that had right here on this earth. And when he talked to a disease, it fled. When he talked to a devil, it was delivered. When he talked to the dead, they lived. When the blind approached him, they saw. When the crippled, they walked. And that same ruler has given you access that we can see and we can move and we can have our being in the Lord Jesus Christ. That there's nothing too big for God here today or any day that you're ever going to be on this earth. There's nothing too big, nothing too great, nothing too extreme that God cannot prevail. But it comes back to you and I now. It's always going to come back to Christ in the church. Are we allowing God to do in us the work that God desires to do in us? And that question, guys, is sought out in an individual form. You and God. Me and God. If the answer is maybe, I hope so. I'm not sure. Or maybe the answer is just a flat out no, it's not. There's some things I need God to do in my life. And for somebody else, it might be yes, I've submitted myself to the Lord, but I know I can always be better in Christ. But we want to pray right now. And the greatest thing that you ever can do in your life here on this earth is submit yourself totally, unconditionally to Jesus Christ. These altars are open.